I just want to talk about this a little bit. A diverse coalition of more than 30, this is in Common Dreams, more than 30 advocacy groups on Tuesday condemned the bipartisan $738 billion National Defense Authorization Act as a quote-unquote blank check to the military-industrial complex that does nothing to restrain President Trump's reckless foreign policy. With the House voted to on the proposed NDAA expected on early Wednesday, the groups urge lawmakers to vote against the measure. The NDAA is a massive blank check, said the coalition, which includes Win Without War, Move On, and Code Pink. The authorization of $738 billion is obscene, the group added. Further inflating the Pentagon's overstuffed coffers does nothing to make us safer or perpetuates a system that treats military intervention as a solution to the world's problems. Meanwhile, every dollar spent by the Pentagon is a dollar spent not spent on education, healthcare, or climate. When critics attack social spending by ask how will we pay for it, this will be our answer. Now, here are some of the key items here. Bipartisan House and Senate negotiations over the NDAA stripped nearly every provision that progressives had fought for. Now, the House version that the progressives fought for had included blocking border wall funding, a low yield nuke ban, attacking Iran not being covered under the 2001-2002 AUMF, which again is the initial war on terror AUMF that has been used for decades now for global war making, and support to Saudis in Yemen, overturn the transgender troop ban, and repeal the 2002 Iraq War AUMF. The final product increases the Pentagon's budget by $22 billion and gives Trump his long-sought-after Space Force, while doing nothing to end U.S. complicity in Iran and reverse Trump's transgender military ban or prevent war with Iran. So this is obscene. We can absolutely call Nancy Pelosi and the others who helped usher this through the famine four, because they are directly backing a famine and genocide in Yemen. And again, Iran war is still a very real possibility, and that would be a global escalation of beyond catastrophic proportions.
That's so terrifying.
And there is a just, look, it's one thing to say it's politically foolish to give Trump a win on NAFTA negotiations while you're impeaching him. And I agree with that. I think it is politically foolish. I think at the end of the day, it's probably going to be a wash. Just at the end of the day, I think, frankly, impeachment will be a wash. I think it's a good process, whatever, do it, absolutely, sure. I think we'll barely be talking about it by the time we're in the fall. But the notion, let's even say substantively, not for appearance's sake, let's say substantively, I take seriously as someone on the left, as someone who opposes U.S. interventionism, who opposes mass surveillance, who doesn't want a fucking space force, I oppose these things. Now, and I also take I it's not how I view politics, but I have some sympathy, with people who get fixated on Trump, who say it's a problem to have a deeply mentally ill president, as an example. I agree. So you just are giving, and again, this is in previous, there were already three blank checks that Elizabeth Warren voted for, let's be clear, and most Democrats. You are giving this guy space toys, unchecked nuclear arsenal, the capacity to wage war with Iran. This is a couple of months after re-upping the Patriot Act. And so I'm not even doing like a by your logic thing. I just want you to see that the system supersedes all other melodrama. There's contracts to be dispensed with. There's money to be made. There's hegemony to be maintained. And those lives don't matter to these people. Period. Ro Khanna, let's start with number four. Yeah, we'll go to three next. We got to start with four.
You know, Space Force is fine. Like, what's the big deal? It's only a new branch of the military under direct control of Trump.
In space.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, I mean.
What could possibly go wrong?
I would like to have a Space Force. I would just like Macron to run it. Here is Ro Khanna talking about the obscenity of this budget.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I rise in strong opposition to this defense authorization. There are many things that you can call the bill, but it's Orwellian to call it progressive. Let's speak in facts. When President Obama left, the defense budget was $618 billion. This defense budget is $120 billion more than what President Obama left us with. That could fund free public college for every American. It could fund access to high-speed, affordable internet for every American. But it's worse. The bipartisan provision to stop the war in Yemen, stripped by the White House. The bipartisan amendment to stop the war in Iran, stripped by the White House. The bipartisan provision to repeal the 2002, the George W. Bush authorization for the war in Iraq, which is sending our troops overseas, stripped by the White House. At some time, we can't just rhetorically give standing ovations when the president says we're going to end endless wars and continue to vote to fund them. It wasn't just President George W. Bush who committed the biggest blunder of foreign policy in the 21st century by sending us to Iraq. It was the abdication of this body with many members of Congress who voted right with him. My question is, when are we going to listen to the American people? When are we going to do our Article I duty and stop funding these endless wars and start funding our domestic priorities?
And if this goes without saying, this has nothing to do with defense or security. This is about the maintenance of empire. And it's also just about pure corporate patronage and boondoggles. And the only part where it hits people in a real way with voting, job projects. Because basically, this in the neoliberal era is the only version of public works programs we have. Well, we can allocate public funds to get people some actual jobs if it involves building military infrastructure we don't need or that kills civilians. It's also a global market. We sell this stuff all over the place, as do the Europeans, as do the Chinese, as do the Israelis, Canada. As do the Russians, as does Canada. So it's absolutely a moral obscenity, and he's right on every single level. But it's again, I'm not pointing out the hypocrisy here. I don't care. I'm pointing out that the structure of this stuff overrides everything. And at the end of the day, if you're talking about the prospects of human survival and the well-being of the vast majority of people on the planet, also, frankly, recalibrating to a world that is not going to look the same way in the coming decades. It might look much worse, but the power dynamics are changing. It might look better, but the power dynamics are not going to be the same. This is the most important vote that's taking place right now. This is the most important action, and a vast majority of these people are part of the problem in abdicating their duty, period.
Yeah, and I'm really glad he made the connection, too, between increased social spending and a ramping down of the military-industrial complex. I feel like a lot of the time progressives are hesitant to do that because they don't want to imply that it would take away anything from anyone anywhere at any point in time. But as far as I can tell, it's a win-win because we have to ramp down the military-industrial complex for the sake of people all over the world. And we need to vastly increase the amount of social spending that we're doing if we want to provide a decent life for all people.
Definitely. You know, Ron Dellums, the congressman from California, I think he used to do a peace budget in the 80s where he would talk directly about that linkage between the military-industrial complex and what we could do in terms of things like single-payer health care and all of the obvious dividends. There was never a peace dividend post-Cold War. Never. Every year. I mean, it was slightly shrunk. Slightly, and then ramped right back up again. And then there was, you know, the narrative search for problems. There was like the reality that, in the words of Thomas Friedman, that you don't have the golden arches of McDonald's without the plains of McDonnell Douglas, to paraphrase him. So that is actually true. There is a military dimension of sea lanes, of actually the hardware of the global order that was built in the 90s. That's true. But there was also the narrative search. You know, I mean, there was a period in the 90s where it was like, oh, well, the new threat are the Colombian drug cartels. That is going to do, you know, substitute for the Soviet Union in terms of why we have aircraft carriers in Europe. And of course, the war against the cartels in Colombia was used. I mean, there is a reason why Colombia is a forward point for all of the major area for U.S. military adventurism and coup mongering and drug war policy across Latin America.